on the phone with us, one of the greatest trainers in the history of boxing. Robert, so much going on in the boxing world. I wanted to get your take. Let's start with this. Ryan Garcia over the weekend posted some stuff talking that Ryan Garcia has passed away and all that. And then today he did a video. I don't know if you had a chance to see it, where Ryan said a police trying to arrest me. They took away my phone. I don't have access to my Instagram. I don't have access to my funds. They canceled my credit cards. But he did post right now on Twitter, he's still fighting on 420. What do you make of all that? Because you know Ryan, I mean, obviously you know boxing.
You know what, I haven't heard anything because I've been on jury duty all day today. I just got out a few minutes ago, so I haven't had a chance to see or read anything. But that's really sad, you know, especially to hear from somebody that I know, somebody that I, you know, have known for many years, seen him growing up through the amateurs, and a lot of guys in my gym have fought him, and a lot of guys in my gym have beat him, and he's beat some of my guys too. So, you know, back and forth, you know, he's fought almost everybody, you know, and an athlete with so much talent, so much potential, all the following that he has. If it's the way you're saying it, it looks pretty bad. It's just something that sounds pretty bad. I don't know the situation, but I definitely can't wish nobody bad. I hope he his mind, his problems, everything gets cleared up, because you really don't wish that to nobody.
No, of course, he's a good kid. We all know him personally. He's very polite. He's very pleasant. You don't really hear him do anything bad or talking bad about anybody, but he doesn't seem like he's in the best place right now. And Robert, as a trainer, no fighter is perfect. I get that. Everybody has something that they come in a fight with. But if you're dealing with so much on your mind before a fight, it doesn't help your chances to win or perform well, I should say.
Look, Ellie, I think me as a trainer, if it's a fighter that I've had for many years and I've been working with them for many years, because believe it or not, we've gone through that same situation with some of our fighters before, where we tell them, take some time off, take a year off, take 2 years off. When you come back, we'll see how it goes. It's happened to us, Ellie. It's not, you know, I don't want to say names, but it's happened to us. You know, because we've been with the fighters for many years. We've been with the fighters throughout their professional career. So we actually have feelings for those fighters. A lot of times, you know, with somebody like Ryan, who is making a lot of fucking money, people around him haven't been with him for his whole life. They haven't been with him his whole career, and obviously they want to make that money. They know it's a one shot, maybe his last, and they want to make all the money out there possible. You know, I don't know this, like I said, I don't know the situation. I don't want to think that they don't give a fuck about him, but it is reality, you know. Trainers, managers, promoters, people around them, people that work around them, they want to get paid. They want to make money, and it sucks. You know, it sucks that if that's the case. I don't know the situation, but it would be pretty fucked up if they still want to force him to fight if he's having those kind of problems. I think if it's really that bad, man, you know, give him some time off, let him relax, and postpone the fight or something. But it's business. You know, I don't know. A lot of people see it like that.
Well, we're not sure the situation. I wish him the best, and you wish him the best. But I want to ask you this. He said in the press conference, Devin Haney accused him of doing coke. And Ryan said, I don't do coke, but I smoke weed and I drink alcohol. How do you feel about that, Robert, about smoking weed and alcohol? Where obviously it doesn't make you a better athlete, but Roger Mayweather told me once, if a fighter drinks, let him drink. He said, Ellie, if a fighter smokes, let him smoke. Don't change who they are.
You know what? I don't change that in my fighters either. You know, they're all grown men. They all know what they're doing. They know what's right and what's wrong. Would I prefer them not to? Of course, you know. But they, you know, I'm not nobody's babysitter either. You know, they might drink. They might be smoking weed also. But do I think it's right? Of course not. I don't think so. You know. But right now in this world that we're living in, man, you know, that's something that everybody wants to do and everybody's doing. So it's hard. It's a hard situation. I don't think it was right of him to say it publicly, because he has a lot of followers, a lot of kids and young boys and girls that look up to him. Man, you know, when I heard that, the first person I thought about was Bear. You know, Bear loves Ryan Garcia.
Your
Bear
grandson, cried. Who's 5 years old, yeah.
Yes, Bear cried when Ryan got knocked out by Tank. As soon as the first person to call me and send me a message and leave me a message was Tata Tata. Ryan Garcia is fighting Devin Haney. And then when I was able to talk to him, I asked him, and who's going to win? Of course, Ryan Garcia. So he looks up to Ryan Garcia, and he's only four. He's going to be five in a few months.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want him to see that Ryan saying that he's, oh, yeah, I like to drink and smoke weed. You know, I don't want to see Bear see that, because if he really looks up to him, you know, he's going to think, oh, man, well, maybe it's all right for anybody at that age or anybody young to be doing it. Does it look good? Of course not. But that's, you know, like I said, who doesn't do it, man? I don't, you know, I cannot tell you how many, or I've never even seen any of my fighters, but I'm pretty sure some of them, maybe most of them, smoke weed. I don't know. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, it's illegal in many states. It's a different world right now. And the commission in New York, from what you know, I know Nevada and California, they don't test for it. Did they test for it in New York?
I'm not sure about New York. I really don't know. I think Texas still does, right? Didn't what's name get money,
yes,
for that?
Keyshawn Davis, that's true.
Yeah, Keyshawn Davis in Texas. So I don't know if there's any, I don't know which states do, which states don't. I guess I could find out whenever my father, if one of my fathers ever did positive, you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, we do know, Robert, we do know that Texas is very strict on any eyes, because you had a fighter that had LASIK and they didn't let him fight, and then they didn't let Mares fight out there when he was supposed to fight and his eyes were okay. So I know,
really,
yeah.
New York is very strict when it comes to the eyes, yeah. Very, very strict. New York is, you know, I think, right now we can't say much, but we were very close of having a fight in New York, and we couldn't have a fight in front of New York just because of the eyes.
Wow. And then I want to ask you this, switching gears for a second. Last week, it was reported everywhere that Canelo's leaving PBC. A lot of people were celebrating on that. Nothing to celebrate. I mean, but, you know, he moved. It's his career. You told me he's the boss. Now it looks like he's coming back to PBC, and his next fight will be Mungi on PBC. Business, what do you make of all that, Robert?
See, that's why he fought and went through everything in the beginning of his career. You know, how many fights did it take him to get there? And there's pictures of him with Eddie Reynoso when he was like 15 or 16, and, you know, in the ring after a fight, you know, and to make it to where they're at right now, man, wow, you got to respect everything they went through since they were 15, fighting in small shows in Mexico, you know, making zero money, you know, to where he's at right now. He calls the shots. He does whatever he wants. You know, I don't blame him. Would I love to see him, you know, fight Benavides? Hell yeah. Do I think he needs to? Yes, I do believe he needs to show it to the world. But he doesn't have to. He could say, fuck everybody. I'm not going to give you guys the fight that everybody's asking for. And I'm not going to give it to Benavides for whatever, you know, the dad, Benavides himself, the brother, whatever they've said about me. You know, I just don't have to give it to you guys. I think he needs to. I think it would be fucking, you know, something in his distance that would change his whole career, you know, the way people think about him. But it doesn't have to, man, you know. And him going back and forth, you know, PBC, now, you know, Matchroom, then from Matchroom, he was like going back to PBC. That's just the power that he has. He does whatever the fuck he wants.
Yeah, and a fight with him on Mungia will be entertaining. I mean, we'll all watch it.
Oh, it'll be big if it is that fight that's gonna happen. Oh yeah, especially after Mugia's last performance against Ryder, the guy that Canelo couldn't knock out, and Mugia dropped him a few times and stopped him. I think that would make the fight a little more interesting. So yeah, Mexico versus Mexico is gonna be a huge fight.
Now, this was reported last week, but things may change as it's boxing. But they said Tank and Benavides will be on the same card. I think that's very good. I think all the cards should be more stacked up than just one good fight.
Cool. Tank?
Tank will fight Frank Martin. and David Benavidez.
Said Jackie Benavidez on the same card with Canelo.
No. That would be sick too. No, no, same card as themselves, but it's not for sure. Things could change. But if they,
well, that would be big, especially now that PBC is doing only pay-per-views, then man, that would be a really nice card, man.
Don King used to do four of those fights in one card.
Yeah, Don King used to do those and a few other world title fights that were not even on the pay-per-view. Earlier in the day, that was Don King, but you know, we don't see that anymore, man. It's just it's just different now. But that would be nice if Tank and Benavidez are on the same card. That would be huge. Hell yeah, I would love to see that.
Yeah, it's not official, so I don't want people to celebrate yet, but they're talking about it. Yeah. Now, Jake Paul fought this weekend. He beat a guy that hasn't been active in a while that had 19 pro fights, and he beat him. He stopped him in one round. And something very strange happened. Amanda Serrano comes out and said his doctor came in the locker room and said that I can't fight because I have an eye injury. Robert, in all your years of boxing, have you ever seen a doctor come in the locker room to check eyes?
Well, that's pretty weird. You know what? I read a little bit. I really didn't even know what had really happened. I read a little bit, but yeah, that is weird. You know, that, you know, in the locker room, the day of the event, I don't know. It's just... I don't want to say something that maybe is wrong because
we don't know. I
don't know what happened. Honestly, you know, about Jake Paul, I'll tell you one thing: he's doing what everybody else does. You know, I have guys that are building up the record little by little. We pick the opponents. We choose the right guys so they could win and look good. If people start complaining about them doing that. Well, about Jake Paul doing that, I don't know why. You know, he's doing just what everybody else does as a professional fighter. The first few fights of the career, they're always taking care of the opponent. The only difference is Jake Paul is headlining pay-per-view events and making millions of dollars.
Yeah, and he's selling out venues where most fighters starting out 4, 5, 6, 10 fights are just on the card of the undercard. They're fighting at 3:30. Big news today, though, Robert. It looks like Gallo Estrada needs to change his nickname from Gallo to, I don't know what, Rabbit? Because he doesn't want to fight Bam, Robert. They do not want that smoke. What's going on with Bam and Gallo? I thought they wanted to fight.
Yeah. You know what? He's always come out publicly saying that he's not very impressed with Bam, that he doesn't seem big of a deal. Like, you know, saying he could beat him. But when it comes to working on the fight, it's been pretty hard finalizing the fight. We're on board already. We already agreed to the fight. We even took maybe a little bit less money than what we're supposed to, because we want the fight to happen. That's the fight that we want. We need it. You know, but he's also being a businessman. He's trying to get as much money as possible. It's still not a no. We still hope the next couple of days we were able to finalize it. You know, he still hasn't said no. You know, there's still a chance. You know, we're waiting on him. But I have a feeling that it will happen. Ellie, honestly, Gallo is a great fighter, pound for pound, one of the best fighters, one of the best for Mexico. You know, for sure. In the last 20 years, I think he's probably been one of the most talented fighters out of Mexico. So. We would love to share the ring with him. I've talked to them, him and his trainer personally, and they've agreed that they do want the fight too. So I don't know, you know, I think they're just doing what anybody else would do, you know, get as much money as possible. That's my only guess, but hopefully it does happen.
Well, I hope they fight. I think Bam's a tremendous, one of the best pound-for-pound fighters, and Guy was a great fighter. So I don't know. I'd love to see that fight personally. So, and then you have another fighter, Ramiro Ortega. He's fighting in a couple weeks, correct, on the Oscar Valdez card?
Yes, he's fighting March 29 in Arizona on the Oscar Valdez card. There's gonna be another big fight also, the unification for the undisputed between Cenisa Estrada and the other girl from Costa Rica. Can't think of her name.
Yoka Valle, something like that.
Yeah, Yoka Valle, but that's gonna be a great fight. So Raymond's on that card. We have Lindolfo Delgado on that card also, and Art Barrera on that card. But yeah, Raymond is already ranked number 2 in the WBC, right behind Camarón Cepeda. Camarón Cepeda is actually fighting for the title eliminator. I want to say it's for the IBF title eliminator.
So he's out.
So, yeah. So that's gonna put Raymond as number one. So, you know, I'm pretty sure he'll be looking into getting a title shot, hopefully with by our next fight.
And Shakur is the WBC champ.
Yes.
So what do you think about him and Shakur, Robert? Yeah, I'm sorry.
I would love that. You know, why not? You know, to be the best, you gotta challenge yourself against the best. And Raymond is up for it. You know, Raymond is very talented. Raymond has told me that he's ready for anybody at 135. So it doesn't matter. You know, the WBO is also gonna push him pretty high because you know, like there's some titles going vacant right now at 135. So there's fighters that are fighting for another title. So he's gonna move up another two or three spots on the WBO too. So he's gonna end up being like two or three in the WBO also. So he could also fight the winner of Navarrete versus that European guy that he's fighting. But it doesn't matter. You know, Raymond's ready for the world title, and hopefully his next fight after March 30th will be for a world title.
So Crawford's in Puerto Rico this week, and he went to the WBO. They gave him a ring because all of the title defenses. They asked Crawford, who do you want to fight next? And you know what his answer was?
What was it?
Canelo, Canelo, Canelo. So Floyd Mayweather does an interview, and Floyd says he wants Canelo, Benavidez wants Canelo. They should fight each other. Do you think that's a realistic fight, Crawford against Canelo? Benavidez? Sorry, Crawford, Benavidez?
I think Benavidez is too big for Crawford, even though, yeah, he wants to fight Canelo at the same weight division. But Canelo's probably as tall as Crawford. Benavidez is just too tall for him. I wouldn't want to see that fight. I wouldn't even want to see Crawford fight Canelo because, I think Crawford gives Canelo some really good rounds. The first six, eight rounds would probably be very, very good. Probably I see Crawford winning probably most of the first six to eight rounds. But then eventually, I think Canelo is just too strong and has fought in that division for so long that he'll take over after that. And it might be where he, you know, we might see him hurt Crawford in the late rounds. But I see the first half of the fight, at least the first half, I see Crawford probably winning those rounds because he's game, you know, he's a solid guy.
Like,
against Benavidez, man, Benavidez is just too big, too difficult.
That reminds me, like, when Amir Khan fought Canelo, he had some success in the early rounds.
Exactly.
Until Canelo caught him, and that was it. That was curtains.
Yes.
But that punch would have knocked out a horse.
Right.
He fainted to the body and caught him upstairs.
Yeah, it was a fucking scary knockout.
Yeah, it was. So right now, so Crawford looks like he's going to leave PBC, but like we just saw with Canelo, nothing's final. Dan Rafael reported that he didn't like the three fights they offered him. They offered him Charlo, they offered him Erickson Lubin, and I think the third one was Boots Ennis, and he didn't like those three fights. Boots.
I don't blame him. The one with Boots would probably be the better one, the one that he would probably, you know, consider doing. But he's also at a situation where he wants the biggest fight out there, and Boots might not give him the biggest fight out there, and it's probably the one with the most risk. Charlo and well, I don't even know who else you mentioned.
Erickson Lubin, Hammer. You know Hammer.
Yeah, but I don't think the world would be too excited about watching those fights.
So what does he do? He's 37 years old. He's going to be 37 this year. Yeah, that's
he's
true.
He's going to retire, and he's already invested his money right. He's already done really good. I had a talk with him a few weeks ago in Vegas, and man, he's got the right to only pick the biggest fight out there, which will be Canelo. If he gets that fight, of course, he's going to make $20 to $30 million and bring that home. But if he doesn't, he already has more than that in his bank account. So he doesn't have to fight anymore. He already went through, like I told you about Canelo. I don't even know why Canelo's still fighting, honestly. You know, all the money that he's made, Crawford has made a lot of money in Omaha, Nebraska. I'm pretty sure the dollar is worth a lot over there. So he's probably done the right investment.
He invested. He bought about 40 homes around his childhood home. Exactly. 40, Robert. Not one, not 10. Exactly. 40. So, and he probably paid them all off.
Yep. Just do the numbers. How much can he be making a month on just those houses?
Oh, he's,
you know,
good.
I mean?
Yep.
He doesn't have to fight anymore. He's retired he could be retired and live a very comfortable life, especially in Omaha, Nebraska, man, where the cost of living is
correct.
Is more affordable.
Yeah, you're right. It's not California or New York.
Exactly.
So let me ask you this.
Crawford, person, it's like a fighter from California, who's making $10 million. Crawford, in reality, Crawford's making like 20 or 30.
Correct, because so, it goes longer where he lives. In California. The taxes and everything of the cost of living is very high over here.
Exactly.
So let me ask you this: Arnold Barbosa is working because he's ready to step in for either Ryan or Haney, and he's realistic that he knows he may step in, right?
I think that's the best position he could be in. I'm happy for him. He's looking for this big opportunity for so many years. He was with Top Rank. Top Rank couldn't give him that big shot. Now he went to Golden Boy, and it looks like he's very, very close. Because in reality, you know, anything could happen with Ryan, and if he pulls out, then Barbosa Arnold is there to fight Haney, and that's a huge fight. That's what he's been looking for. So, you know, that was, you know, for him, it was a great, great move to move over to Golden Boy. And now, obviously, Golden Boy and his management team to put him on the on that card, Ryan versus Haney, because anything could happen, especially with everything we're hearing about Ryan. He's very, very close to stepping in and fighting Haney. That's beautiful for him.
And Barbosa, 29-0, a very polite kid, a good kid. I don't know if you ever met him or dealt with him, Robert.
Yeah, I haven't, man.
Very chill kid.
They're great people, man.
Yeah, and the thing is, it's like, this is what you want in life. What if he gets the Haney fight and he shocks the world and no one even gave him a chance?
So that's what I mean. He's in a perfect position right now.
And then what happens to Haney when he thinks he's fighting Ryan? If the fight doesn't happen, what goes through his mind? Does he lose motivation?
They're also, look, with Haney, the way he looks, the way he's been raised, and the way it looks like he's very dedicated. He never loses focus. It looks like he's one of the most dedicated fighters in the world.
Yes.
It looks like we might be seeing another Mayweather.
Okay.
And his dedication and everything. And talent also. So I don't think it'll affect him, but you know, knowing that you're fighting somebody that big and then you end up fighting somebody not as big, then it has to hurt.
Yeah, the money's not going to be the same, the excitement, the pay-per-view, but it's still a big fight. We're still going to watch it. But again, exactly. As of now, Ryan just posted that he's fighting, and his dad said, oh, he's just doing, how did Henry phrase it? He's just using the wrong way to promote the fight. But I don't know, talking about death or taking your own life is nothing I would like joke about, Robert, because we all know people who dubs on that, and it's not a good thing, you know? You can't joke. It's not, you don't promote a fight using stuff like that.
Exactly. No, you don't do that. I wish him the best, man. Ryan's a great kid. I think, you know, Ryan might be one of those, you know, he might need to take some time off, spend time with new people that are not fucking around, that are not doing stuff like that. Cause maybe his circle around him is what's probably hurting him a little. I really don't know. I think he needs to maybe get to a place where he's gonna be around nothing but positive people, clean people, you know, no celebrity status. You know, everywhere Ryan goes, you know, he's a celebrity. So, you know, he needs to hide for a while and just clean himself out and forget about everything, and maybe that'll change his life around.
Hopefully, and listen, when you're that famous, Robert, let's say you go to a club, they give you the most alcohol for free. You go to a restaurant, exactly. Everybody gives you everything for free, whether it's, I don't know in his case, but I'm saying in general, what I've seen from my experience, when you're famous, you don't pay for nothing. And it's hard to say no if you like to drink.
Of course.
So, you know, it's one of these things where for a boxer, it's very bad to drink, Robert. Liver, kidney, calories, really especially you have to make weight. And a lot of fighters that I know drink because their original reason they told me, and I've heard this many times, we have trouble sleeping, alcohol help us fall asleep. I know it's their excuse because there's other things you could do, Robert. You know, but when this is what they told me. When they cut drastic weight, they have trouble sleeping. Is that true?
It is true. The last few days, it's always hard to fall asleep because you're thinking of, you know, obviously cutting weight and thinking about all this, the fight and everything. So it is hard.
But alcohol actually is nothing but calories. If you're like beer, it's not good. You know, it's not going to help you with your weight cut anyways.
Well, I'm pretty sure it's not going to help. You know, I don't know. I never drank before when I was fighting. So I really don't know. You know, I always, I had a hard time falling asleep, but maybe Tyler Pien, it was the answer to me.
Yeah, but then again, you were raised very strict, and your dad probably wouldn't let you drink or smoke, so it was not an option for you.
I never did. Yeah, I never tasted a beer until after my last fight.
Yeah, but that's the way it should be, I think. To be honest with you, Robert,
it should be like,
if you're a professional athlete...
Look at Mayweather. Mayweather's a perfect example. Devin Haney right now. I'm pretty sure Devin Haney, you know, is very careful with that. I'm pretty sure Mayweather was very careful with that. So, you know, that's what people need to see. Those are the fighters, young fighters need to look up to.
Yeah, no, I agree. Listen, it's a sport that really, Robert, it's not fun because it's 24/7, 365, and your level of dedication has to be, you can't, there's no off season. You always have to be in shape and always have to train. And I'm sure it's not fun, but everybody got into it because they enjoyed it, right? At some point.
It's true. That's true. That is true.
And I don't know. So we're going to monitor that, of course, and see what happens with all that. But in the meantime, it's been a really interesting year with almost no major fights announced yet. But I wanted to ask you this. So I'm watching Ray Ford this weekend. Did you happen to catch the fight?
Yes, I did. I watched the fight.
Okay, give me your breakdown of what you saw, because I saw Ray Ford not winning, and then the other guy kind of no mas style turned his back. Robert, what did you see there?
Look, I think Ray Ford is very talented. It's great. I'm happy for him. I was happy for Maxwell also. Great win for the team.
They made a champion. Yep.
Since they signed, you know, Trump and all that, which is great for him, for the company. I thought the other guy was winning, and I think the judges had him winning. I think at least two judges had him winning.
Correct. 106, 103, yeah.
You know, the last round, the guy did get hurt, and Ford jumped on him to stop him. But I don't think he turned his back like trying to say he didn't want to fight anymore. I think one of his legs, I don't know which one it was a little... I think something happened to one of his legs, and he kind of like stumbled a little, tripped a little, and had to like fall into the road. So he turned his back, but I don't think he turned his back like saying he didn't want to fight anymore. I think that's what the ref believed and thought he did. That's why he stopped it. But I think he should have just given him an eight, standing anchor, because he went into the rope, so that was kind of like a knockdown. And the guy would have won. But, you know, I also don't want to blame the ref also. You know, I think Ford also deserves that win. He fought, you know, he fought like very few do, knowing that they're losing and they're behind, went out there for the last round because he knew he had to win by knockout, and he did. So I got to give him credit for that. But I thought personally that when the guy fell into the ropes and turned his back, I don't think he did it purposely to say he didn't want to fight anymore. I think it was more his leg giving up on him and his body turning, not knowing that, you know, that the ref was going to stop it. I really believe that.
Yeah, no, I agree, but it's boxing, and no one's arguing that you know, they stopped the fight and he won. But what I noticed, Robert, from my perspective, I've only been around boxing 15 years, and that's not a lot of time compared to people that have been in their entire life. If the opponent, and I Kolmakov, however you pronounce it, I've interviewed him when he was young, when he was like 4-0, 5-0. I have some videos. I called him Bruce Lee of Uzbekistan. But if he would have been a little more sharp and just taken a knee instead of turning and running, there's 10 seconds left, he wins the fight.
Yeah, but you know, there's fighters from this other country, the Eastern European guys, they don't believe in fucking taking a knee, Ali. What the fuck are you talking about?
I'm talking about
a warrior.
Yeah, he's a warrior, but he's not a...
I'm telling you, there's no way he turned his back either. He doesn't do that. Those guys don't do that. I think it was more his leg gave up on him. He didn't, you know, so he was falling down and forced himself to turn around. And I think the refs stopped it thinking, oh, he's giving up and turning his back. Army, so that's what I believe. You know, I could be wrong, but that's what I believe. I think he should have given him a standing head count because he did go into the ropes, so the ropes knocked him out. So that should have been an head count, but he should continue to fight and he would have been champion. But I'm also very happy for Ford, that, you know, Maxroom, they did a great job. You know, I'm very happy for them.
Yeah, no, of course. And listen, I'm happy for, he's a great kid. Everybody from all over boxing had nothing but good things to say about him, which is very rare. And for Eddie Hearn, all these years in boxing, is finally he took a kid. I always say with trainers, Robert, to me, a great trainer is if you could take a kid that never threw a punch and make him a champion, I think you're amazing. Because it's easy to take a guy that somebody else built for years and years and years, and you're just coming to fight number 29 in his career, and you're the greatest trainer.
Of course.
So taking a kid.
With a promoter.
Exactly. So Eddie Hearn finally did it, and he has his first champion that he built from the ground up. A kid that hit him up on Instagram and said, hey, you should promote me.
That's awesome. Good for him, man. I'm happy for them, definitely.
Did you ever have a kid hit you up on social media and then you signed him because of that and he became a champion?
We've had a lot of kids that we see on social media, and they're in my gym right now just working out. Maybe they're not the best fighters, but there's a lot of them that call me on social media. Hey, can I come? Actually, one of them came in today. He'll be training tomorrow. He through social media, I never met him or anything, and he's in the gym right now.
I'm going to stop by tomorrow. Tomorrow. What's his name?
I don't even know his name, man. Honestly, man, but he's there. He called me. He sent me a message because I was in court all day, so I didn't. Yeah. I haven't been able to talk to anybody. But he said, "Oh, I'm here." And I said, "Hey, well, go to the gym. I'll be there tomorrow because I'm in court right now."
That's funny. Yeah, but you know what, Robert? You used to have a sign in Oxnard. I remember all your signs, but one sign said, "Hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard."
100% right.
So necessarily, you can have the most talented kid in the world, and you've had some of those, but they were lazy and not dedicated, and they faded out. And then you have a kid like Brandon Rios that wasn't the most talented guy on the planet, but guess what? Became a world champion and multi-millionaire.
Exactly. That was Brandon. He's one of the perfect examples, you know. But there's very few like Brandon, man, bro. There's very few like Brandon. There's not many like that, you know. You don't see those. You don't see those that often. Honestly, it's hard to find another Brandon.
So, Robert, just end this interview really quick. What's your message to your fans, to the boxing world, if they're tuning in?
Look, you know, I just thank everybody for all the support. You know, I was in San Antonio this weekend with two of my guys that fought over there on our show right there. Myself, you know, House of Champions Promotions and Boxer and Brawlers in Texas with my boy Albino and Marcos. You know, we did a show. It was a sellout arena at the Techport Arena. The people showed nothing but love, a lot of support. Then I flew back in Saturday morning too, because we had one of the kids that turned pro in Ensenada, Mexico, and again another. It was a smaller venue, but it was also sold out. It was packed. People show nothing but love. You know, whenever they know I'll be there, and they know I have a fighter or two on the card, they show up, man. You know, I love that. That's something that I'm always gonna appreciate from the people, especially in Texas, man. They give us nothing but love. So I'm very, very happy, you know. We just gotta continue doing this in Texas, in Mexico, in Ensenada, Tijuana, wherever, you know, we go, people show nothing but love.
That's amazing. That's how you build a brand, Robert. Going on the road one event at a time, small, like a singer, like a performer. Because everybody at some point will show you, the smallest fan will be the biggest fan, bring his family, friends. So when there's pay-per-view, they all tune in. So there you have it, guys. Correct. Make sure to follow Robert Garcia Boxing. A lot of big news coming soon. And hopefully Bam gets the fight with Gallo. And hopefully Ray gets a shot at the title. Stay tuned. Nelly Setback reporting. Hold on. I'm Ellie Setback reporting for ESNewsReporting.com. I'm Ellie Setback reporting.
ESNewsReporting.com.
I'm Ellie Setback reporting.